Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I'd like to welcome you to the second in a series on challenges for Muslims in the 15th and the 21st century. The 15th being the 15th century after the migration of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, from Mecca to Medina. This is the Muslim calendar. And the 21st century being the calendar that most of us go about through the world, being the calendar of the Christians and called the Common Era calendar. So our topic is a very big one and a very important one, challenges for Muslims in the 15th and the 21st century. We've organized the topic into five areas, the first area being challenges we face in the 15th and 21st century. The second show focuses on our responsibility to our neighbors. That's the topic that we'll take up today. The third show focuses on the very big issue of what is a Muslim leader. The fourth show will be focused on the post-victimization ethical exemption syndrome, the post-victimization ethical exemption syndrome, what we call the PV syndrome, which we feel is a major block to Muslims dealing with the challenges that they face today in the 15th and the 21st century. And the final show will take up the topic, building infrastructure wherever we are. We've had one show before, and as we said before, that show dealt with challenges we face in the 15th and the 21st century. And in that, we dealt with what are called the three Ds: despair, a psychological worldview that keeps us from moving in the direction that we need to move in order to be positive contributors to the world; disorganization, this is a difficulty that afflicts our local and our national organizations; and the third is disconnection, that is disconnection from the Quran and the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I mean, this is a major problem because on the one hand, people have the Quran, but they don't read it and heed it. On the other hand, we have the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, and we don't use it as a GPS system or guidance system like the ones that many of us who have cars use in our cars. And that we feel that if we get away from this disassociation, then we'll be able to deal with the challenges that face Muslims in the 15th and 21st century. So that was our first program. We're now in the second episode of five, and we're looking at the whole issue of responsibility to our neighbors. The first point that we should understand is that if we look at Islamic literature, if we look at the hadith or the reports of things that Prophet Muhammad did, said, or allowed, we'll see that the rights of neighbors are very, very important. There's a sound hadith. You'll find that angel Gabriel admonished him so much to be kind to his neighbor that he, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, thought that he was going to have to put his neighbor in his will. This is a major, major issue. And we find from a review of the literature that it doesn't matter whether the neighbor is a Muslim or a non-Muslim. Because if the neighbor is a non-Muslim, he or she has one right over you. If the neighbor is a Muslim, he or she has two rights over you. The first right being that they're Muslim, and so Muslims have rights and obligations toward one another. And the second right in the case is because he or she is a neighbor. So this is a major, major point in Islam to understand that the neighbor has rights and we are obligated to fulfill the rights of the neighbor. We shouldn't even sell our property. I'm given to understand from Islamic scholars, unless we offer our property to our neighbors first, as an example of how important these rights that we have to our neighbors are. So this sets the stage for our understanding of our responsibility to our neighbors, that we find in Islamic law this whole notion of a series of obligations that Muslims have to their neighbors, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim. If they're Muslim, of course, they have larger obligations over them. I'd like to frame this discussion in three ways and to take up three topics. This is a very big topic, as the whole topic is a very large topic, by talking about three R's. One is looking at the situation from the whole situation of responsibility to our neighbors. Two is looking at real value. And three, looking at the whole issue of responsiveness. And so if we look at our responsibility to our neighbor, we have to look at the whole question of what the word of responsibility means. The word responsibility means accountability. And if we are accountable for something in this life and the next, it's a very, very important issue. Well, we need to understand that if we look into the Quran, we'll find that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is a witness to the Muslims, and Muslims are a witness for all humanity, including the neighbors. This is a grave, grave responsibility, because this calls for Muslims to be a role model for their neighbors. Indeed, no matter where we are, no matter what we're doing, we understand that we're being watched, particularly in this day and age, with the kind of media coverage that Muslims are getting in this day and age. The reality is, as people are watching everything that we say, we do, or we allow to happen in our presence. So therefore, this is a responsibility to be a role model for all humanity. In other words, in the final analysis, my understanding of the Quran, when it says that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is a witness for Muslims and we are a witness for humanity, is that we have the obligation to put the best foot forward when we're dealing with non-Muslims. So therefore, we should watch what we say when we're in their presence, and we should watch what we say all the time, because we have, from the Islamic perspective, we have two angels that are recording everything that we say or do. But we have this added responsibility, this added accountability to be a role model. So therefore, we should watch what we say, because people are looking at what we say, and particularly, as we said, in this particular environment, when the media covers us in the way we do, we should guard our tongue. And as we know, this is a very, very important part of Islam anyway. And so we have a responsibility for guarding our tongue. We have a responsibility for what we do in the presence of others in order to not make Islam look like it's a religion of just words and not deeds. And so this responsibility for being a role model, this accountability for being a role model, is extremely important. And many of us only act like Muslims when we're in the company of Muslims. In one sense, it's more important to act like Muslims when you're in company of non-Muslims. Because the reality is that if you're in the company of Muslims, the Muslims, alhamdulillah, all praises due to Allah, are likely to be able to correct you. But if we're around non-Muslims, whose behavior is often very different from ours, we don't have that situation. We often say that you can't be around people, being the social animals that we are, without either them affecting your behavior or your behavior being affected by them. And so therefore, we are the ones who are called, according to the Quran, to be witnesses for all humanity. And so therefore, we shouldn't be following after the ways and the mores of the non-Muslims. We should be exemplifying the excellence in character, the excellence in good deeds, the excellence in work that will be a good role model that is the kind of responsibility that we should have in relationship to the non-Muslim. So that's the first R, responsibility for being a role model. If we understand that, we have begun to build on what our overall responsibility is to our neighbors. The second R in the three R's for responsibility for our neighbors is real value. The second R is real value, R-E-A-L, V-A-L-U-E. That is to say that if we are living in a society, if we're part of a community, if we're part of a neighborhood, that our living there, our being there, should be of real value to that community, to that society, to that neighborhood. If we look at the example of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, even before he received the revelation at the age of 40 years old, he was of real value to the community. What do I mean? He joined a philanthropic or charitable organization before. What do I mean? He was a productive member, a worker in the community. He wasn't very rich, you know, before he became a prophet, and when he was very young, because he was an orphan. But he was a productive member of the community. That is, he worked in the community. He worked as a shepherd. He worked as a trader in his community. What do I mean? As by being a person who was of such good character, he was known as Al-Amin, He was known as the trustworthy one even before he received the revelation that was part of his prophethood. And so we should add value. And this is why one of the reasons why people would come to him, and we have many famous stories about him, for advice. So as we look at our role and our responsibility to our neighbors, that very, very few people, both Muslims, talk about, and very, very few Muslims, non-Muslims even know about. And so what we've been attempting to do is to put it in the context of our overall topic, that topic being challenges for Muslims in the 15th and 21st century. And what we're trying to do is provide a viewpoint that's helpful to both Muslims and non-Muslims at the same time. And so in this particular program, thus far, we've looked at the whole issue of responsibility for being a role model that Muslims have to non-Muslims. And also, we've looked at the issue of real value, R-E-A-L-V-A-L-U-E, that it is incumbent upon the Muslims, wherever he or she lives, to add real value to the situation in which he or she finds themselves. This is part and parcel of our deen. We must pray, yes. We must give charity, yes. We must fast in the month of Ramadan, yes. We must make Hajj if we're physically and financially able, yes. But we also have this obligation to our neighbors that we should add real value to the situation in which we find ourselves. If we understand this, then when we look around us, we'll find that if we take up this position, we will be facing the challenges of Muslims, the challenges that Muslims have for leadership in the 15th and the 21st century. This is a topic that's very close to me, simply because where I live, our neighbors are extremely important to us, simply because I live in the United States of America, where Muslims are in a minority, and we are surrounded by non-Muslims. We'll take up a little more of this issue of real value and finish with a last R right after this break. We hope you'll join us after the break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. I'd like to welcome you back to a conversation on challenges for Muslims in the 15th and the 21st century, where we're taking a look at, in today's episode, we're taking a look at our responsibility to our neighbors. In the prior episode, we took a look at the challenges we face as Muslims in the 15th and 21st century. And in the episode after this, we'll take up the big question of what is a leader. As we pointed out at the beginning of the program, this is part of a five-part series around the big topic, challenges for Muslims in the 15th and the 21st century. And we're doing this for three reasons. Number one, to help Muslims understand their obligations, both within and outside the Muslim community. Number two, to provide some clear, sound information about leadership in Islam to non-Muslims, those who are interested in Islam, possibly taking Shahada, and as well as those who simply want to learn about Islam as a neighbor. This will counteract some of the distortions that Muslims see. And the third reason is to provide a real a role model or a paradigm for people to look at as an alternative way of leadership than the one we often see in the societies in which we live today. As we said, this is the second of our series of programs. This program focuses on responsibility to our neighbor. This is something that very, very few people, both Muslims, talk about, and very, very few Muslims, non-Muslims even know about. And so what we've been attempting to do is to put it in the context of our overall topic, that topic being challenges for Muslims in the 15th and 21st century. And what we're trying to do is provide a viewpoint that's helpful to both Muslims and non-Muslims at the same time. And so in this particular program, thus far, we've looked at the whole issue of responsibility for being a role model that Muslims have to non-Muslims. And also, we've looked at the issue of real value, R-E-A-L-V-A-L-U-E, that it is incumbent upon the Muslims, wherever he or she lives, to add real value to the situation in which he or she finds themselves. This is part and parcel of our deen. We must pray, yes. We must give charity, yes. We must fast in the month of Ramadan, yes. We must make Hajj if we're physically and financially able, yes. But we also have this obligation to our neighbors that we should add real value to the situation in which we find ourselves. If we understand this, then when we look around us, we'll find that if we take up this position, we will be facing the challenges of Muslims, the challenges that Muslims have for leadership in the 15th and the 21st century. This is a topic that's very close to me, simply because where I live, our neighbors are extremely important to us, simply because I live in the United States of America, where Muslims are in a minority, and we are surrounded by non-Muslims. And so it has a practical aspect as well, in the sense that not only are we following the Quran and the Sunnah when we involve ourselves in beautifying the community, when we involve ourselves in the neighborhood watch activities, we involve ourselves in civic activities, we in fact are adding value in a way that makes the neighbors want to protect us and respect us, and hopefully some of them, and we know some of them, want to be part of us. And so if we look at our responsibility to our neighbors, we'll find the three R's, as we've said before. The first R being our responsibility to be a role model. The second R to add real value, to the situation in which we find ourselves. And the third R is to be responsive, to the situation in which we find ourselves. What do I mean by this? It's one thing to say, well, I'm a good neighbor. I say hello to my neighbors. You know, I keep my yard clean. I do those kinds of things. But in reality, it's being responsive goes far beyond that. Am I saying that Muslims have a responsibility to be like their neighbors? No. Am I saying that you have a responsibility to provide every need that your neighbor has? No. But what I am saying is that if there's a need that you can provide, if you can make life better for the people around you, it is your obligation to do so. I offer a way of focusing on this by looking at what I say are the three C's. One is being clear, or clarity. Clarity, that's all. Being clear on why you're doing what you're doing. That is, we fulfill our obligation to our neighbors because we do it because this is something the Creator or Allah loves, and this is something that is a hallmark of the way of the Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings be upon him. He was kind to his neighbors, even neighbors who were not kind to him. There was a woman who used to sweep dust in his way all the time when he would walk from his house to the Masjid al-Haram, the big masjid in Mecca, and she was a neighbor, and she would always try to do things to obstruct his way, and he spent time, going back and forth from where he lived in order to pray near the Kaaba. The reality is that one day she didn't show, and he asked about her, and this is a woman that lives in his area, in his vicinity, and who's not Muslim, and indeed was going out of her way to be rude to him. And so when he heard that she was sick, he went and visited her. And we have many, many stories like this. And so, but as I said, we have to be clear. We have to have clarity is the first. See, we have to be clear that what we're doing it only to please our Creator. And a side benefit, right, is what happens in terms of bringing hearts together, making for a strong community. And in some cases, if we read the biography of Prophet Muhammad, some of the people, the neighbors he was kind to, became Muslims. But the main reason that we're doing it is order to please our Creator or please God and follow the way of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. That's the first thing, to be clear about that. The second thing is to have a commitment to it. That's to say that this is a part of what you want to do and where you want to go, and that you want to understand that in order to be focused on being a good neighbor, you have to make sure that you understand what this is about. So your commitment should be one in which you are focused on trying to do things on a long-term basis that would provide the good for the common good of the neighborhood in which you live. The third thing is commitment, clarity, and competency. That is, to do things in a way that are beneficial and not to do them in a way that are not beneficial. And therefore, if you don't know how to do something, you don't volunteer to do something that you don't know how to do. And so this is the way you're responsive. You live in a multicultural community where everybody is not of the same ethnicity, of the same religious background, and you're trying with great difficulty to be responsive to the needs of your neighbor. So these are the kinds of things that we focus on when we talk about being responsive to the neighbors. Above all, understand, when we're talking about being responsive to our neighbors, as we've said before, this doesn't mean that we're becoming exactly like them. What we're trying to do is show that we are going to be the role model for all humanity as ordained by the Quran and as appointed to by the model of our beloved Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So we can see that we have a responsibility to be role models for our neighbors. We hope that in this particular segment that we focus on as part of our large discussion about challenges for Muslims in the 15th and the 21st century, our responsibility to our neighbors. In doing so, we hope that we've helped the Muslim understand his or her obligations in the sense that we have a civic responsibility, a civic duty, this is what we call it in this day and age, to help out our neighbors and to be there for them. I hope that we've been helpful to the non-Muslim, and hopefully it's cleared up some misconceptions about Islam in this particular regard. If you have a neighbor who's a Muslim, you have rights over him or her. And I hope that we've begun to outline a model of action for responsible leadership in the 15th and 21st century. What we hope to do in the next program is focus on what Muslim leadership is as a part of our larger discussion of challenges for Muslim leaders in the 15th and the 21st century. We hope that you'll find it a way to join us. We hope that this will be a benefit to you, and we hope to see you for the next episode. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.